Evening, everybody. My name's Tom Morgan. I'm with PS21. PS21 stands for Portsmouth Smart Growth 21st Century. Thank you all for coming. PS21 presents ideas about city planning issues in Portsmouth with the aim of stimulating discussion and engendering a more livable and sustainable community. Our topics over the last 3 years have included walkability, public transportation, development of the North End and the West End, parking, favorite subject here in Portsmouth, architectural design, tactical urbanism, and climate change. Tonight we're going to hear about accessory dwelling units, or ADUs. I'd like to thank the sponsors. Our season sponsors are the Jeffrey Clark and Martha Fuller Clark, founder of the New Hampshire Charitable Organization, also the Piscataqua Savings Bank, and the Coraway Film Institute. We are a grassroots group, and our funding's kind of hit and miss, so we have a little jar out front, and we appreciate any donations if anybody's feeling generous. Tonight, our speakers are Ben Frost and Rick Tainer, and we'll be hearing about ADUs. Ben will explain the new state law that the legislature passed last year. It's going to take effect on June 1st. And then Rick will walk us through the city of Portsmouth's response to that responsibility that's been placed on the municipality. There'll be a brief question and answer period after Ben's talk, and then we'll move on to Rick. Ben Frost, first speaker, he serves as the Director of Legal and Public Affairs for the New Hampshire Housing Finance Authority. Ben brings two key perspectives to this talk tonight. He is both a seasoned professional planner and also an attorney. And you couldn't ask for more appropriate perspectives on the issue that we'll be talking about tonight. So Ben has saved us the trouble of getting an additional speaker. We have them both right in one there. He's going to explain the details of the new law and provide us with a little context of what's been going on in New Hampshire the last few years that prompted the legislature to do what they've done. Ben, could you tell us about the new law?
Thank you, Tom. Good evening, everyone. Where but in Portsmouth would you get this many people coming out to listen to a talk on accessory dwelling units? So congratulations to you for being so engaged in Byzantine planning topics. But I'm going to try to lift this out of the Byzantium and bring it to contemporary day. Well, actually, no. Let's go back in time, because accessory dwelling units really are a very old idea. You know, we are, and this is Mesa Verde in the Southwest. I forget what state. Where is Mesa Verde? In Colorado? It's right near Four Corners in that area. We are accustomed as a species to living oftentimes in close quarters with one another. And certainly you experience that here in Portsmouth, which is a pretty densely built community. But it's not unusual. For my part, I do not live in a densely populated area. I live in Warner, which is, for those of you who don't know where it is, it's where Boston stops on its way to Vermont, on I-89, exit 9, that's where the Market Basket is and the McDonald's. If you keep going in a little bit on the road, you come to this beautiful little town center. It's a town of about 2,800 people. I happen to live outside of town, and I think this is part of the choice that that planners need to make, and as we as citizens need to make too, recognizing that people do want to have choices. So some people choose to live in dense environments. Or in the local parlance of where I'm from originally, Ipswich, Massachusetts, thickly settled. But other people choose to live in the hinterlands, like me. I live on 11 acres in the midst of 1,000 acres of conserved land, and it's paradise for me. I can't walk to anything except woods, but that's okay. So it's a simple and old idea. Old, certainly. Simple, kids get it. I mean, so this is Lego, a Lego set. Okay, so this is actually the Golden Hall of Edoras from the Lord of the Rings trilogy, you'll recognize. So what is that next to the Golden Hall but an accessory dwelling unit? Yeah, it's a stable, I'm kidding, but you know, you get the idea. But when you talk to kids about planning ideas, they come to really basic concepts like, well, why shouldn't people have small, decent places to live? Kids like small places, like, you know, playhouses. And you might think about an accessory dwelling unit as a playhouse in a one manner of speaking. Now, to take it up another step, I do greatly miss Downton Abbey. What a wonderful show. But what is Downton Abbey but a single family home? A really big one. And where do the rest of the people live who aren't living in Downton Abbey? So where do Mr. Carson and Mrs. Hughes, by which names they continued to go even after they were married, where did they live after they were married?
Accessory dwelling unit.
In an accessory dwelling unit, a detached accessory dwelling cottage on the estate. But you know, what better example of a detached ADU than their cottage? So, you know, this is something that comes up in all kinds of contexts. What are accessory dwelling units? They go by lots of different names, but basically they are a second, smaller dwelling on the same grounds, whether attached or detached, as a single family home. And we'll get to the attached and versus detached thing a little later on. You know, it can be an apartment over a garage, can be where your post-college child lives in the basement. How many of you are experiencing that? Some of you, I'm sure. And not wanting to admit it, probably. Or an outbuilding. Think about a chicken coop that's converted to a dwelling. And actually, I talked with someone last night who lived in such an environment. I know it was a perfectly well done because it had been rehabbed totally. They go by lots of different names. Granny flats, mother-in-law apartments, family apartments, secondary units. Lots of different names for the same idea. But I want to focus in on this single word, accessory dwelling unit. This is a word, so I'm a lawyer, words have meaning. This is a word that has special meaning in this regard. What does accessory mean in the phrase accessory dwelling unit? And this is essentially the legal understanding of what accessory uses are in common law. So something that is customarily incidental or subordinate to the primary use. What does that mean? So customarily incidental. It's commonly associated with it. That's what that means. Historically, within the community in which the use is occurring. And subordinate to the primary use. Well, what's the primary use? Single family home. Subordinate to means it's gonna be smaller, lesser of an impact. Now, there's a lot of case law on what is meant by accessory uses, not so much on what is meant by accessory dwelling units. So, for example, years ago, there was a case out of Peterborough that involved a person who owned a single family home and wanted to have a gun shop. And the question was, is that an accessory use? Yeah, the court wrestled with that, and my recollection is they ultimately determined it wasn't. But you can see how, you know, take it back 150 years, 200 years, and you say, well, yeah, of course people worked out of their homes. And we have a lot of that going on here in Portsmouth, too, a lot of people working out of their homes. Now, you might say, well, even in places where home occupations aren't allowed, how many of you take your work home with you and work on your computers at night or on the weekends? Is that a home occupation? Arguably, yes. But what's really coming to the fore is, what is the impact upon other people, neighbors, for example? So is it customarily incidental? Should your neighbors expect a certain type of use to be occurring in that environment? Or should they not be surprised, or too surprised, when it does? This is a bit of a sales pitch. What are the benefits of ADUs? I'm sure you can come up with some of your own, but I want to focus on a couple of them. The efficiency of the use of land. You've got existing development, and here's an opportunity to increase the housing stock without effectively much more land developed. You're not building in green space, really. You're building in people's backyards, or carving out a portion of an existing dwelling, or building an outbuilding in the backyard. It can be, although is not necessarily, affordable. But because the units tend to be smaller, They draw lower rent than the larger structure, whether, and I'm using that in a strictly economic sense, rent, you know, whether you're the owner or a renter, you can talk about the economic rent of a property. It improves the homeowner cash flow. Think about how many people in a high property tax environment who are struggling to pay their tax bills. A lot of us. And this is an opportunity for people to be able to use a portion of their property to help offset the costs of property taxes and whatever other bills they may be facing. And then finally, you know, it's helpful to people who want to age in place or people who have disabilities who might need a caregiver but want to have some privacy of their space as well. So those are some of the benefits. Here are a couple of examples of ADUs, and this is a really good website, and I'll repeat it to you. It's www.accessorydwellings.org. This is one guy who just loves accessory dwelling units, so he created this website and has a lot of examples from, in particular, Oregon, the Portland area, but elsewhere as well. So here are a couple of examples. The one on the left is from Eugene, Oregon, and that actually, I think this is a laser pointer here. So this is actually a mother-in-law apartment. The owner's mother-in-law lives in there. But you're looking at it from the street, you can't tell what it is. It might just be a great room or a family room or a mother-in-law suite as it is. This in Portland is in Portland's historic district, so you can imagine the rigors of the permitting of that. This is at a garage that was converted into a very small, I think 460 square feet, two-story accessory dwelling. And I was just looking at my notes, and I noted for the first time that this, the one on the right in Portland, is actually used for short-term rentals. And I know that's an issue in Portsmouth. Closer to home. This is in Hopkinton. If you're driving up 89, I encourage you to take exit 6 and turn right off the ramp, and you'll see this old farmhouse that's been converted to, actually, it's not necessarily an example of an accessory dwelling unit, but conversion of an older building to multiple residential units. So imagine this as maybe one single family home with an accessory apartment. It's actually 4 or 5 units, done really tastefully, beautifully, in fact. So from the road, you can't tell what's going on there. Only from the back can you see that there are multiple entrances, multiple electrical meters. Really well done. And lots of space in this property too, so there's not much of an impact on the neighborhood. There's frankly not much of a neighborhood there. So I challenge, some of you may have seen this before. If you have seen this before, you can't play the game. The game is find the hidden ADU in Warner, in this property. Where is it? Where do you think?
Upstairs.
Indeed. That is exactly where it is. How do I know? I used to live there. So this, and this is a story that I use to demonstrate the importance of a healthy rental market. Rentals are really important for labor mobility. So people can come into an area when they get a job offer and figure out where they want to live. They don't want to necessarily go in and buy something in a community that they're not really sure about. So when my wife and I were creating our household, she was working in Lebanon, I work in Bedford, Warner was kind of halfway in between, and so we rented this apartment in Warner, in the Davisville section of Warner, for 6 months, and it was our introduction to Warner, and we have since bought a house there. We love it, it's a great community, I call it blue collar with an artsy edge. It's a really cool town. But had it not been for this rental unit, we might not now be in Warner, where we are volunteering on local boards and adding to the community, whether it wants us to or not, I'm not sure. So ADUs, and I talk about the history of it, you know, it goes back a long ways, but here in the US, ADUs were really common in single family homes up through, say, the early 20th century, but post-World War II, our land use patterns changed significantly. And this is a result of a lot of different factors. Part of it is the baby boom, lots of new population, car boom, the ability of people to by cars and the construction of highways so that people can move from place to place fairly efficiently, and sprawl, which was in part a result of the sorts of zoning ordinances that we were promulgating as planners, so-called Euclidean zoning, which is named after a U.S. Supreme Court decision in 1926, Village of Euclid versus Ambler Realty, Euclid, Ohio, in which the Supreme Court of the United States upheld local zoning as an exercise of the police power, that is, the power of the government to protect public health, safety, and welfare. Now, this case, in this case, it was Justice Sutherland who was writing for the court, and he said, you know, he said that it might be the notion of incompatible uses might be the right thing in the wrong place, in his language, like a pig in the parlor. Pig is the right thing, the wrong place. So you might think, well, okay, industrial uses, residential uses, yeah, they don't really belong together. So you can see why you would use zoning to keep those two sorts of uses separate from each other because of the negative impacts that one might have on the other. Certainly, industrial uses may negatively impact residential uses. Same way, residential uses can negatively impact industrial uses because of the complaints that property owners have. But actually, this case, Euclid versus Ambler Realty, was about the separation of single-family homes from multifamily homes. So I guess multifamilies were the pigs in this case. It's a point of sensitivity for me, I'm sorry. Okay, so we have all these different factors that have added to and compelled us to use land differently through a significant portion of the 20th century, including easier mortgage financing. But things are changing, we know this. So this is from the Pew Center. This is a study that they published in May of 2016. And just focus on the headline. Living with a parent is the most common young adult living arrangement for the first time on record. And the record being going back to 1880. So that's a fairly significant historical record for this kind of data. Think about that. Living with a parent, this is for people ages 18 to 34. Living with a parent is the most common living arrangement for the first time on record. This is significant. Why are our young people still living at home in increasing proportions? I am hearing lots of answers here. It was kind of rhetorical. Especially so for young men. Now, why is that? If you look at, and you go, this is from 1880 to the 2014, which is the last date of the data, look at 1960. You get this peak of men and women living independently of their parents, and then this long trend down to the present, where they are increasingly living at home with their parents. But men especially so, young men especially so. And I think, and if you read the study by the Pew Center, you'll recognize what they're calling out is the disproportionate impact that the decline in manufacturing employment has had on men versus women. So men have been left out of the equation in employment in increasing numbers relative to women. So lots of things going on. So that's what's happening on one end of the age spectrum. We also know that here in New Hampshire, we are an old state. This is not new news. So the American Community Survey, which is the census's replacement of the long form, is done every year. In 2015, they pegged New Hampshire at being tied with Vermont for being the second oldest state in the country, behind Maine. This is changing too, and New Hampshire actually, I believe, is aging faster than Vermont, so when the 2016 data come out, we'll probably see New Hampshire in exclusively second place ahead of Vermont. But if you listen to demographers like folks at the Carsey Institute, they'll tell you, well, New Hampshire's an old state, but that's just the median. If you understand statistics, you'll recognize that the median has a very specific meaning. It doesn't mean we're all really old. It just means that half of us are older than that age. But for New Hampshire, what's going on is we have a lot of baby boomers who aren't really old, but are getting there. So looking at this other Pew Research Center data, look at New Hampshire, and you can kind of see the colors. Just focus on the colors, not the county boundaries or things like that. And this is the county by county across the country. The darker the color means a higher proportion of the population in that county that is over age 65 or 65 and older. So New Hampshire is not really dark, not like Florida or certain parts of Arizona or Nevada. It's not really dark. It's kind of middle of the road. And that is a reflection of the fact that we don't have a really old population. We just have a lot of baby boomers who are older than the median. But this too is changing, because what happens over time? We get older. A couple of years ago, New Hampshire Housing commissioned the New Hampshire Center for Public Policy Studies to do a study of housing needs and preferences in New Hampshire. And when they came out with a draft report, I said, this, I think, is the most important chart in the entire study, because it shows so much, and I could spend a half an hour talking about this. It shows so much of what's going on with New Hampshire's population. So focus, this is different groups. So from a housing finance agency's perspective, we're interested in people who can buy or rent. So we start at age 15, not that you're buying or renting at age 15. But this group here is typically your first-time home buyers. Then you get families. We probably should have another category in here, empty nesters, and then elders. Look at the blue line, and that's 2010. That's the base year for this study. What you see is the peak. That's the baby boomers. That's the big slug of baby boomers in our population. Now, what's going to happen to that group over time? They're going to get older. They're going to spread that curve out, which means that New Hampshire is going to be likely a very old state relatively soon, because we're not replacing ourselves over time. So you see, here you have millennials and Gen X and baby boomers. Nationally, millennials are, in absolute numbers, the largest generation, bigger than the baby boom generation. But not in New Hampshire. And that's in part because of the fact that we are actually a very white state. And I look here, this is a fairly white room. And people who are white tend to have fewer children than people who are not. We are not replacing ourselves. So we have the olds and the youngs doing different things in the population. A couple other things that came out of the study, and this also is not new news for us. New Hampshire is growing a lot more slowly than it used to be. Say 17 years ago, roughly, New Hampshire was growing at the pace of a Laconia every year. You know, about 17,000 people added to the population every year. And that's mostly because of in-migration, mostly from Massachusetts. It's not happening now. Now we're growing by a couple thousand people a year. The second bullet point here, this mismatch point, this is the fundamental conclusion of this study. There is fundamentally a mismatch between our existing housing stock, large single-family homes, and the needs and desires of the population increasingly. So what we have is an aging population that wants smaller homes. We have those who are here, the younger population, want smaller homes. And what we've got is big homes. We know that older adults want to age in place, but maybe they can't because they can't care for the property. Certainly they want to age in community. Places like Portsmouth. So I asked, what does this all mean? What are the housing implications? We need to house an aging population that is going to have very specific needs as they age, as we age. And we need to attract a younger population to replace ourselves in the workforce, and we're not doing that. What are the policy implications of this? And finally, do we see these different populations competing for the same housing resources? And in some cases, yes. So this is actually a micro apartment in New York City on Manhattan. And it's, I think, it's like 400 square feet. But it, you know, you look at it quickly, you might say, well, that's an assisted living apartment, other than the location of the microwave oven and maybe some, an extended counter. But it's the sort of attributes you might see. But probably it's appealing to the younger set. Now, one difference that we have between younger and older people competing for the same resource in housing is that older people tend to have more financial resources. They can be a cash buyer, whereas a younger household cannot be a cash buyer. So the older household is always going to win out in that fight. And why are they fighting over the same things? It's because we don't have enough housing. So now turning to the law, the accessory dwelling unit law. The backstory is all of those demographic changes that are occurring here in the state and the experience that home builders have had in trying to meet their clients' requests. Can you build us an accessory apartment for mother, mother-in-law, father, father-in-law, caregiver, child that we don't want to be living with, but we want to keep an eye on? And what the home builders were finding was across the state, from community to community, the local regulations were saying, no, you can't do it. Or had said yes, but and imposed all sorts of onerous conditions. And so the home builders sought legislative relief. And they found sponsors in the legislature, Senator Fuller Clark among them, to create this law on accessory dwelling units. So here's the law, the basics. There is a definition of what is meant by accessory dwelling unit in the law, but there's more to it in that in the statute, and I call these the defining characteristics. The law, the definition talks about a separate living unit on the same property. It's an independent living unit with sleeping, cooking, eating, and sanitation facilities. If it lacks one of those, it's not an accessory dwelling unit under the law. I had one building inspector ask me, well, this guy wants to build a cottage in his backyard, but you know he doesn't want to have a kitchen in it. I said, well, it's not an accessory dwelling unit. But there are a couple other attributes in the law that aren't part of the definition, but must be present in an ADU in order for it to be an ADU. First off, the owner has to demonstrate the adequacy of water supply and sanitary disposal on the property. So if you're on public water and public sewer, fine, it's no problem unless you're at capacity. And I know that's an issue in Portsmouth too. But if you're on a private well, I'm not sure how you demonstrate the adequacy of the supply of in a private well, other than if you turn the water on and it flows. But the sanitary disposal, the septic system, this has been a sticking point in a lot of communities. Some communities have said, well, you've got to build an entirely new system if you want to have an accessory dwelling unit. I don't know, what proportion of Portsmouth's residences are on septic, anyone know?
Very small.
Small, yeah, I mean, it's as I would expect. So it's not so much of an issue for you here. But in most of the state, it is an issue because most of the residences in most communities are on septic systems. So there has to be some demonstration of adequacy of water and sanitary disposal. And we'll get to this a little more later, there has to be an interior door between the primary unit and the accessory unit. So the law is really dealing, first off, only with attached accessory dwelling units. So you can, if it were detached, there couldn't possibly be an interior door. There are some reasons for this. One of the reasons might be that it allows the owner to more easily reintegrate the accessory dwelling unit into the primary unit at some point in the future if there is in place an interior door. I was asked by some wise guy, well, you know, if we put in a door and then sheetrock over it, is that an interior door? I said, well, yes, but I don't think that meets the statutory intent. It has to be a functioning door. So those are the defining characteristics. What is the role of the municipality in this new law? You have to allow an attached accessory dwelling unit in any single family home, or well, more accurately, in any zoning district in which single family homes are allowed. And you can do this by right, meaning no special permits required other than a building permit. By special exception, which means Zoning Board of Adjustment, or by conditional use permit, which typically means planning board, but not always. So those three ways, by right, by special exception, by conditional use permit. If the zoning ordinance is silent on accessory dwelling units, then they are allowed in any single family residence, whether that is conforming to the zone or not. So most communities are responding to this law by dealing with it in some way. Though that is those communities that have zoning. And there are still, I think, 19 municipalities in the state that don't have zoning, most of them up north. And finally, and this is probably one of the, this is a critical aspect of this law. The standards for a single family home also apply to the combination of the single family home and the accessory dwelling unit. That means no extra setbacks, no extra frontage requirements, no extra lot size requirements, no extra density requirements. So think about what you're trying to regulate here. And I have a picture I'll show a little later on. What can you do? There's actually a lot of flexibility in this law. And this is partly in response to concerns that were raised by legislators, particularly in the House, when it went before the House Municipal and County Government Committee. And that committee in the House retained this bill over the summer of last, in 2015, and earnestly worked on it and came up with, I think, an improved bill. So you can require adequacy of parking. And what does that mean? Well, that's up to you to determine. The Municipal Association has recommended two parking spaces for an accessory dwelling. I think that's excessive, but you know, I can see why they say that. Because you may have two occupants, both of whom have cars, and they have to go somewhere, and they don't want them on the street. This was a concern expressed by a representative from the city of Manchester, which has a parking problem. I know, my daughter lives in Manchester, and you know, when there's a storm, good luck. You can require owner occupancy of one of the units, but you can't say which one. You can't say the owner must live in the primary unit, but you can simply say you must live in one of these units. How do you police that? Well, you can do an annual permitting mechanism where the owner comes in and files a permit for the ADU. I know some communities do this, and certifies that this is that they are living in this property. They are occupying it. You can also require a demonstration that it is the owner's principal place of residence. It is their place of abode for automobile registration purposes, for voting purposes. This is not a foreign concept for municipalities to deal with. You can control for architectural appearance. And in the language of the statute, it says aesthetic continuity with the single family residence. I call it look and feel. How you do that, well, that's up to the municipality to decide, as long as you have some sort of standard in place and don't make it an arbitrary decision of a building inspector or zoning board of adjustment. You can limit the number of ADUs to a dwelling to one if you want to. I only ever thought of there being just one, but I suppose you could have more than one. And you can, and let me be careful about how I have phrased this. The law does not prohibit municipalities from limiting the number of unrelated individuals who occupy a single unit. This is the Durham provision of this law. So the representatives from the town of Durham were very concerned about this law, and they wanted to make sure that they could continue to enforce their maximum of, I think, three unrelated individuals per dwelling unit. Hanover, likewise, I think, has a standard of four unrelated individuals. It's a college town problem, but not exclusively. That does not mean that those sorts of restrictions might not be struck down for other reasons based on other laws, such as the Federal Fair Housing Act. So any community that is considering that kind of restriction, I urge caution and urge you to talk with your legal counsel a lot. What can't you do? You can't limit an ADU to one bedroom. You can't require it to be smaller than 750 square feet. You can allow the owner to build it smaller than 750, but you can't require it. I believe Portsmouth has set a standard of a maximum of 750, which actually is consistent with the law. You cannot, remember we call these mother-in-law apartments? You cannot require a familial relationship between occupants of the units, not just for mothers-in-law. And remember that interior door? You can't require that it remain unlocked. How many of you have been renters at one point in your lives? How many of you have had a crazy landlord? You want that door locked. How many of you have been landlords and had a crazy tenant? You want that door locked. But this is a provision that some municipalities have used to limit who will actually use an accessory dwelling unit. If you require the door to be unlocked, who's going to police that anyway? I'm not sure. But if you require it to be unlocked, then really you're only looking at family members, I think. And I've already talked about the lot areas. We'll get to detached ADUs. Okay, so I said I have this thing I wanted to talk about. What is it we're trying to regulate? If your concern, as it should be legitimately here in a place like Portsmouth, if your concern is density, consider a couple of different factors. So here we are on Mulberry Street. You've got half-acre lots, well, 20,000 square feet, 100 feet by 200 feet. And you've got these fairly large post-World War II houses, 2,500 square feet, with a garage. What's the impervious surface coverage of this? 20.6%. Okay. If you add an accessory dwelling unit in the dwelling unit, you've increased the ability of the property to be used more effectively, more efficiently. You created another residential unit without increasing the impermeable surface. Add on out back, you've added a little bit to the impermeable surface. What is it you're trying to regulate? Is it the density? Is it water quality? Is it surface water runoff? Because there are other things that could be allowed under your zoning ordinance that might have a much greater deleterious impact on groundwater, surface water, and the surrounding environment. So if you're a basketball aficionado, a 96-foot by 50-foot NBA regulation court with a roof gives you 53% coverage. You love cars, you build a big garage and pave the entire backyard, you get 61%. That's going to have a much greater environmental impact than one of those two accessory dwelling units. A couple other things about the law. Detached ADUs. Remember I said it really deals principally with attached accessory dwelling units. That's the obligation. The law says municipalities at their sole discretion may allow detached accessory dwelling units if they want to. It's up to the municipality. If you do, then the one dimensional standard you can vary is lot size. You can call for an increased lot size if you have a detached ADU. And then I'm not going to talk about 674-21 because it's really arcane. So this is Senate Bill 146, signed into law by Governor Hassan on March 16th of 2016. It goes into effect, as Tom said at the outset, on June 1st, 2017. This gives all municipalities in the state a full town meeting cycle. I know that's not relevant here in Portsmouth, but most of the communities in the state are operating under town meeting form of government, whether it's official ballot or traditional town meeting, and most of them have a town meeting in March. Some in May, a couple in April. So they have that full period of a year in which to deal with this. And I think a good number of them have dealt with this fairly effectively. What's going on now, though? There are a couple of bills pending in the legislature. Senator Fuller Clark has introduced one of them, and that is the first one, allowing municipalities to limit ADU short-term rentals. And I know that that is a really important concern with Airbnb and VRBO and other similar rental mechanisms. Unfortunately, the Senate committee that is handling this has voted to kill the bill, recommend that the bill be killed. It will go to the Senate, I believe, in 2 weeks.
Tomorrow.
There may be, and I think this is a fairly important bill because the law was not intended, in my view, as one of the authors of it, it was never intended to allow for short-term rentals. It's intended for longer-term occupancy, for the workforce, not for vacationing tourists. But there may be another opportunity later in the session to deal with this, even if the Senate kills the bill tomorrow. There's another bill in the Senate that would prohibit the Department of Environmental Services from imposing additional septic requirements for accessory dwelling units. And this is a reflection of the rulemaking that DES did last year to account for accessory dwelling units, which requires increased tank size not necessarily increased field size, but increased tank size for septic systems because of the peak flow that you get coming from two households working on the same system at, say, 6:30 or 7 o'clock in the morning. I get the point. This is a bill by Senator Avard that would prohibit DES from requiring that, and I believe that is going to go to the Senate tomorrow, probably for passage. And the last one is a House bill by Representative Carolyn Matthews of Raymond that, and I've worked on a lot on this bill, that would allow municipalities to limit accessory dwelling units in townhouse environments. So think of, you know, condo townhouses, to limit them associated with manufactured housing, which is a concern for some people, I suppose. And most importantly in this bill, to allow municipalities or to prohibit future condominium conveyance of accessory dwelling units unless the municipality wants to allow it, and some do, especially up north. So that is going to the House tomorrow on the consent calendar and is likely to pass, and then we'll go over to the Senate. So here's a bunch of FAQs which we can focus on later, and we can bring that slide up when we're in Q&A. But I do want to give a shameless plug. As we age, and this is not necessarily about housing, really, but as we age, we are going to have a population that is increasingly disabled, whether mobility or vision or hearing. This is a film that is going to broadcast, have its broadcast premiere on New Hampshire Public Television tomorrow evening at 8 o'clock. I encourage you to tune in. The film is called Getting There. It was a film that was sponsored by Plan New Hampshire and the New Hampshire Planners Association. I happen to be the producer and one of the executive producers, and I am, yes, in fact, related to the filmmaker who is seated in the back. Matt, would you please stand? Okay, so that's my son, Matt. He has made this film, which is going to be on New Hampshire Public Television, and it is a really important message about a disability in the built environment, not just housing. There's an important housing issue there, but more generally, how we build things. I think we can do a much better job than we have in the past. So if you have later questions, I strongly encourage you to email my colleague, George Regan, who is our housing awareness coordinator. If you email me, I will try to get back to you as well. We can do a couple of questions now, and then we'll move to Rick's presentation, and then we'll do a more general discussion. Yes.
Question over here. Jack Gardner speaking. Why is the legislature hesitant about the short-term rental issue? Why are they
the question is, why is the legislature hesitant about the short-term rental question? I was not present for when they exact the bill, when they were in their deliberations on it. I did talk with the chairman yesterday, and he said, and he had voted against the motion to kill the bill, and he said, he told me differently. Okay, well, now we have a difference of opinion here. He said he thought that there was it was a property rights issue. That's the best explanation I got from him.
Just one second question quickly.
Can I just say Senator? That the real estate people, I guess, came in and objected strongly to putting any parameters around how a ADU could be used.
Okay.
So you come back to that property rights issue, but you know, we've a long time ago adopted zoning, which is trying to strike a balance between property rights issues and community rights, and but didn't.
Okay, so the Senate will vote on this tomorrow, apparently.
A second question, if I could. In other parts of the country that have done these programs, they all start with the best of intentions, but abuses do seek it. What abuses have been found in other places that's been tried, and how have they been handled?
Well, I'm not sure necessarily what kinds of abuses there are. I And I'm drawing on my experience as a municipal planner here in New Hampshire. I was the planner, 20 years ago, in Hollis, which is one of the most, if not the most, affluent community in the state, and has, since the early 90s, allowed ADUs by special exception. And they did that because they recognized they had a lot of illegal accessory dwelling units. The zoning didn't allow it. And so they, instead of enforcing against all of those illegal units, they decided to allow them and to regulate them. And they allowed the owners to a period of, I think, 3 years to come into compliance. So I think in the absence of some sort of regulation on accessory dwelling units, you're going to find a lot of abuses. But where you have a mechanism to regulate them, and so I would encourage, and I forget how Portsmouth is doing it, but Rick can talk to it. I encourage communities to use the special exception ability, which takes a permit to the ZBA, or conditional use permit, which, as I said before, typically goes to a planning board. That allows you to know what's going on, have a mechanism for imposing conditions, reasonable conditions on the use of property that are consistent with the community's desire and that are also consistent with the state law. I didn't answer your question directly, but I have difficulty thinking of what the abuses are in the abstract.
I own property in Portsmouth, and we have a second house on our property, but it's zoned as a two-family. The property zone is two families, so I was wondering if the smaller property is considered an ADU.
That really depends on how your zoning ordinance is written, and so I without looking at the zoning ordinance, I can't answer that. But I will go back to this. Aren't we just talking about duplexes? And the answer is no, because a duplex is a specific use. It is essentially, typically, two co-equal units on a as part of a single structure mm-hmm. on land. Now, you're talking about
two separate structures.
You must have something in your zoning that allows that to happen, whether it's the lot size or it's a pre-existing non-conforming use.
Yeah.
I don't know. But I would not necessarily characterize that as accessory. Are they two? If they're two single-family homes, then one is not accessory to the other. Mm-hmm. They're two single-family homes. And with that, I think I will.
We're going to give you a rest, Ben. Thank you very much. Very informative. And there will be plenty of opportunity for more questions for Ben after the second speaker. And the second speaker is going to be able to address the type of questions that you raised as what's possible in the city of Portsmouth now. Our next speaker is Rick Tainer. He's the planning director for the city. He's been planning director for 8 years. He's actually been in the city a bit longer than that. He was working on the previous master plan. And he's going to tell us about the city's response to this new legislative mandate. He's well suited for that task because he's the principal author. And he also worked with the Portsmouth Planning Board and the City Council to come up with a solution that everybody was on board with. Rick, could you tell us about the new zoning ordinance that was adopted in January?
Sure. Let's see. Okay, thank you. Well, that was a very entertaining presentation, and I'm not going to be nearly as entertaining for those of you who know my presentations. So I'm going to talk about Portsmouth. There are a lot of slides here. I'm going to run through them very quickly, but there'll be a lot of opportunity for you to ask questions about them. One of the things that Ben mentioned about the law is that under the law, communities are required to allow accessory dwelling units in some form, whether as of right, by special exception, or by conditional use permit, in any zoning district that allows single-family dwellings. And this map, although the colors may not be as easy to see as other they should be, shows all of those districts. So that includes our rural district, which is basically for single-family homes on five-acre lots, our single residence districts, our general residence districts, which are closer to the downtown, our mixed residence office and mixed residence business districts, and then four of our character districts, which have been adopted over the past few years in the downtown, the north end, and the west end. So most of the areas that are white on this map are either general business districts, and of course all the area out at Pease, and then some natural resource districts. So a fair amount of the city is subject to the ordinance. And when we were putting together the ordinance, we tried to do an analysis of what this potential impact would be. And so we looked at various districts around the city and just try to get a sense of how this might play out over time. And this first set of maps is looking at various zoning districts and neighborhoods in the city just from the aspect of minimum lot area. So the lots on these maps that are highlighted in red or sort of a purple color are lots that are already too small. They're non-conforming as to the minimum lot area requirement. And the way we've thought about this is that in order for a property to be eligible for an accessory dwelling unit, it would at least have to meet the minimum zoning requirements for the zoning district. So in this case, the ones in red would not be allowed. The ones that are in green with a yellow highlight are just over the minimum lot size. And the ones in blue have enough area to qualify to meet the zoning. So this is our general residence C district. It's our densest district. It allows single-family dwellings on lots of 3,500 square feet. It also requires up to 8 dwelling units, but in each case it needs 3,500 square feet of land area per dwelling unit. So it's fairly tight. The buildings occupy quite a dense area of the lot, but you can see in the aerial photograph there still is a reasonable amount of green space. So it's possible that there could be the ability to add on some of these lots some additional units and still have enough open space for the people living in those units. You move to the general residence B district, which has a minimum lot area of 5,000 square feet. This is in the south end, just where the North Mill Pond lets out into the river. And the same thing applies. And you can see here, because zoning was applied after the area was substantially developed, many of the lots in the area could not have an accessory dwelling unit created because they're not conforming to the current zoning. Same thing when you get to the general residence A, which is a 7,500 square foot minimum lot area. And then the single residence B, again, the zoning in many cases makes the existing lots non-conforming just by lot area. It's one of the things we've looked at over time, trying to see if we could rezone some of the areas to make fewer lots non-conforming. And there are issues with that, and it's been something we haven't had a chance to get back to and work on. Interesting, Thaxter Road and so forth, Sewell Road, the entire neighborhood is non-conforming as to lot area. So there aren't going to be any accessory dwelling units in that neighborhood. Just interesting. I don't know what the history of that, why that was zoned that way, but that's just what happened. Then the next step we took was to look at the city a little bit more with a little bit more refinement. We looked at the parcels that do have the required minimum lot area under the particular zoning district, and either have it one single family dwelling or are vacant. And so in this case, any parcel that is highlighted is a parcel that could potentially have an accessory dwelling unit on it. There are other zoning standards that might apply, but this is a pretty good assessment of where accessory dwelling units in the city might occur. So this is the Frank Jones neighborhood and Christian Shores, as well as Osprey Landing and the Atlantic Heights area. Then going down into the south end and between Middle and Islington streets. And you can see there are a number of areas where there could be accessory dwelling units created under the state law. And then moving further out into the single residence A and single residence B and into the rural districts. quite a number. The Woodlands and Ellen Park have quite a lot of opportunity for accessory dwelling units out there. So as we were developing the ordinance and thinking about it, we had some concerns. And the first one I mentioned earlier is that our general residence C district and some of our other general residence districts currently allow single-family dwellings on very small lots. And so right now the maximum allowed density is essentially 6 to 12 dwelling units per acre, which is relatively high for New Hampshire communities. And the general residence districts permit single-family dwellings and 2 to 8 unit dwellings at the same lot area per dwelling unit as a single family. So if you're in a GRC district, you can have 3,500 square feet, you can have one dwelling unit. If you've got 7,000 square feet, you can have two units, and so forth. And then the other thing is that many existing apartments in our zoning districts are at the same size range as are allowed for accessory dwelling units under the state law, less than or equal to 750 square feet. So in that sense, the accessory dwelling unit law effectively doubles the allowed density. And although what Ben said about duplexes is generally true, in Portsmouth under this law, you could take a 1,500 square foot house and create two 750 square foot dwelling units, basically turn it into a typical duplex without having to meet the minimum lot area requirements that would otherwise be required to do that. So it effectively doubles the allowed density for two family dwellings. We don't think that's going to be a terrible issue because we need to find room on the lot for cars, for additional parking of cars, and in many cases there are other aspects of the lot that are non-conforming. For example, they may not have the required frontage. So in that case, they wouldn't be able to get the accessory dwelling unit in there. In terms of thinking about detached accessory dwelling units, remember that the law says that the same zoning requirements apply to a single family unit and the accessory dwelling unit combined as apply to the single family dwelling unit by itself. And one of those standards is building height. And we were very concerned that detached accessory dwelling units, we would be allowing essentially 35 foot high detached accessory dwelling units. And we didn't want to do that because that would be really adding adding density. For example, somebody could take a garage and add a story onto the top of it, which people have done, without going through the more restrictive process of a variance. So we were concerned about this, and we were also concerned about the fact that many of the existing accessory structures, like small garages in our denser zoning districts, don't meet the zoning standards, so they don't meet side setbacks. And in many ways, when the planning board talked about this, in many ways they thought that it would be better to convert those small existing structures to an accessory unit rather than allow an expansion of the existing house, that there would be less impact. You'd get a better, a more affordable accessory dwelling unit with less visible impact in the neighborhood by allowing a conversion of that garage. And that garage couldn't be converted couldn't be converted because it didn't meet the standards for a single family dwelling. So our concerns were impact on neighborhood character, privacy, because many of these garages would be very close to the lot line. They'd be put in the backyard, you'd be overlooking the backyard of the neighbor. And many people, when you saw those aerial photographs, the houses are to the front of the lot, and that's okay. There's a lot of density at the front of the lot, but there's some open space in the back. And so people are concerned about maintaining the privacy of their backyards. And we're also concerned to some extent about interplay between the accessory dwelling unit statute and our historic district, although the historic district commission is fairly strong and could have a lot of control over that to make sure that the ADUs didn't impact the neighborhood too much. So in conclusion, the board really felt that converting some of these existing accessory structures that may not meet the zoning for a single family dwelling would be better for the neighborhood than allowing an expansion of an existing house or the construction of a conforming detached accessory dwelling unit in the backyard. So the way we address this is, I'm not sure, we think it's innovative, we'll see how it works, is to create this concept called a garden cottage. So we've defined it as a second dwelling unit created through conversion of an existing accessory dwelling And we specifically said that it's not an accessory dwelling unit, so it's an additional unit that we're creating outside of the law. And so it doesn't have to, and we're saying it doesn't have to comply with the yard requirements. It's not subject to the same height allowance as the detached accessory dwelling unit. And so we're really allowing it as an alternative to either an attached accessory dwelling unit or a detached accessory dwelling unit, because we think it has less impact than either of those. We want to be able to encourage or to allow the conversion of those existing small garages as a easier alternative than doing an expansion to a house or construction of a new, larger, detached accessory dwelling unit. We hope that it will be less expensive to create and therefore more affordable for the renter. So, again, this garden cottage concept is to allow existing accessory structures to be converted into small dwelling units without having to comply with land use regulations for principal dwellings. It has an explicit statement that it's not an accessory dwelling unit under the new law. And therefore, because we're adding another unit that has two units on the lot, the single family zoning standards don't apply, and the city does not have to provide for, if that second unit is created, that is the second unit on the lot, and therefore there's not another accessory dwelling unit that can be provided. Because it's a third option that we think will be lower cost and lower impact than expanding a house or building a new structure. So the ordinance was enacted in January after 6 or 7 months going through the planning board and the city council. And it defines the accessory dwelling unit, an attached accessory dwelling unit, a detached accessory dwelling unit, and the garden cottage. So that's one aspect of the ordinance is just creating those definitions in the ordinance. And then the components of the ordinance, again, are the definitions, the changes to the table of uses, and then Article 8, Sections 10.8.14 and 10.8.15 provide the regulations that actually implement the state law. So in our table of uses, this is what the section of the table of uses looks like. Going across the top are the zoning districts from rural to the single residence, general residence, mixed residence, the CD districts or the character districts that are in the downtown and the west end and the north end. And then off to the right are the business industrial districts where we don't allow single family dwellings, so we're not allowing accessory dwelling units or garden cottages. And what the CU stands for is that it's a conditional use permit from the planning board. So that's the option that we've taken. We looked at the idea of possibly allowing smaller units by right or smaller units by special exception from the zoning board with kind of more larger units from the planning board. We even talked about allowing certain units that had an affordable housing restriction attached to them by right and others by conditional use permit. But in the end, the planning board decided that at least initially, they wanted to have all of the accessory dwelling units and garden cottages allowed through the conditional use permit. And the conditional use permit is essentially just like a special exception, except that it's the planning board that grants it rather than the zoning board. And then in the ordinance, we have parallel regulations pretty much for the accessory dwelling units and the garden cottages. And I've highlighted some provisions here that we felt were important. And in terms of the accessory dwelling units, we have this provision that one and only one accessory dwelling unit shall be allowed on any lot containing a single family dwelling. An accessory dwelling unit shall not be allowed on a lot that contains more than one dwelling unit. Now, this is something that may be somewhat unique to Portsmouth. We have a number of lots where there are two houses on one lot. And so we didn't want to have each of those houses be allowed to have an accessory dwelling unit. We actually have a development that's being constructed right now that has 10 single family houses on one lot. And we certainly didn't want to have 10 accessory dwelling units to turn that lot into a 20 unit lot. So we defined this to say that not just to the single family dwelling, but to the lot, only one additional unit on a lot, so no more than two units on a lot through this process. Under the garden cottage provisions, we say no garden cottage shall be allowed on the same lot as an accessory dwelling unit. So you've got a choice. You can either do the garden cottage, which is outside the accessory dwelling unit law, or an accessory dwelling unit. And so we've tried to pin that down quite a bit. In the last provision here at the bottom on the right-hand side, we say that a garden cottage that complies with the standards of this section is exempt from residential density standards. So if it doesn't comply, it would require a variance. So in all cases, if an accessory dwelling unit does not comply with the minimum standards here, it's not eligible to get a conditional use permit from the planning board. It has to go for a variance, and a variance requires a showing of a hardship, and it's a higher standard than a conditional use permit. In terms of off-street parking, we have said that we have a provision in our zoning ordinance right now for micro units, and it hasn't been used yet, but it's what we said is that a unit that's less than 400 square feet only requires one parking space. And so we brought that into the accessory dwelling unit and garden cottage provisions, where we're saying that if you have an accessory dwelling unit that's up to 400 square feet, you only are required to provide one additional off-street parking space. If it's over, you need two additional spaces. Parking is, as has been noted earlier, is a big issue, not only in the downtown, but also in some of our denser residential zoning districts and with narrow streets. So we want to make sure that we're not adding to congestion. The garden cottage has a maximum, I should have mentioned this earlier, where the accessory dwelling units have a maximum size of 750 square feet. The garden cottage has a maximum size of 600 square feet, which is approximately equivalent to a two-car garage. So we're trying to provide for conversion of that. And so we're saying that that only one parking space is required for the garden cottage. We have the standards that are required, that are part of the state law. A lot of this ordinance is simply restating what's in the state law. So it requires an interior door between the principal dwelling unit and the accessory dwelling unit. And we actually have found in Portsmouth somebody who sheetrocked over an interior door. So it's not as far-fetched as it seems. And we had them take it out, take the sheetrock off. And so it shall have not more than two bedrooms, not more than 750 square feet of gross floor area, and it should maintain the appearance of a single family dwelling. And one of the discussions, one of the changes that came during the ordinance was that people noted that that some dwellings, because of the way they've grown organically over time, actually have two doors facing the street. And so we said you can have two doors facing the street, but one should really seem like the principal entrance, and one that should really seem like a secondary entrance. We do allow, specifically allow, detached accessory dwelling units in certain districts, and that's on the left-hand side. On the right-hand side, in terms of garden cottages, when you have an existing accessory building that you're turning into a dwelling unit, you're not allowed to expand it either vertically or horizontally. So the idea is to keep the same character of that small, relatively small garage, with the exception of a small entry or a small deck. And the bottom piece, which is not highlighted here, again, thinking about this issue of privacy in adjacent lots, if the garden cottage is within a required side yard for the zoning district, so it's closer to the fence than would be required for a single family home, it can't have any windows or doors higher than 8 feet facing the adjacent property. So it's to protect the adjacent property, their privacy in their backyard. Then we go through the standards for what the planning board has to look at to determine whether to grant the conditional use permit. And at the very end, we have an annual certificate of use to verify compliance with the standards, which include owner occupancy of one of the units and so forth. This is what we think might happen. You might, in our urban neighborhoods, the general residence B and C, the tightest, the areas where we have a minimum lot area of 3,500 to 5,000 square feet, we might get internal accessory dwelling units, in other words, conversion of a house without expanding it, or we might get the garden cottages. When you get out to the neighborhoods that have a 7,500 square foot minimum lot area, you might start to see additions onto the single family dwellings because there might be room on the lot to do that. In the suburban neighborhoods, single residence A and B, and in the rural areas, we're probably likely to see additions and real detached accessory dwelling units rather than either the internal or the garden cottages, because you've just got more room to play with on your lot. We do have an application form now for this. We do not have any applications yet that I know of, although I believe one will be coming in for our next planning board meeting in a case where somebody is proposing to build a garage with a accessory dwelling unit on the second floor of the garage. So this would be a real detached accessory dwelling unit. We have heard from other people who are interested in it. I've talked to one person who is building a house, and he's planning to build a house in such a way that it can be converted to, part of the house can be converted to an accessory dwelling unit, and he plans to move into the accessory dwelling unit and rent out the main house. So there are all these possibilities. So we haven't, you know, we don't have any experience yet. We expect that some of these things will be tweaked as we find applications coming in over the next few months. But there is a lot of interest out there, so I expect to see applications sometime.
Thank you very much, Rick. Some of you know, but in case some of you don't, Rick will be retiring from his position as planning director on April 30th. So this will be a good opportunity to pepper him with questions on ADUs. You may not get another good opportunity. And we do have time for plenty of questions. Doug has a mobile mic, and if you could wait for Doug to approach with the mic, then everybody will be able to hear the question. And both Ben and Rick are available for questions, so are there any out there? Who is this question for? Well, we have an attorney over here on my right.
I'll wait for the mic if you want. Thank you. I live in Portsmouth, but this is a question about a neighborhood that would comply with a detached ADU. In other words, each house in the neighborhood has a garage, and above the garage there's a space that could become an ADU. But when the builder built the neighborhood, he included in all of the deeds an exclusion for developing the garage into an accessory dwelling. Does the state law trump that condition?
That is a good question for an attorney.
Can the state law be used to break the restriction?
No.
No.
Think about homeowners associations and condominium associations and other restrictive covenants on land. Those are private contracts among and between property owners. This law does not trump those.
For a question down front here.
My question is for Rick. If we have a question about our particular property, do we make an appointment with somebody? Do we show up at the department? What's the best way to go about that?
Best way to do is to call the planning department and ask to make an appointment with Vincent Hayes. I mean, you can just call and say you're interested in an accessory dwelling unit, and it will go to him. But he's the person who's really looking at all these right now. I'm going to wait for Ben to tell me we did it wrong, but the way we've written our ordinance is that only, let's see if I can get back to the text here.
It's a single lot.
Not, yep, yep.
And it was allowed to have three freestanding condos, essentially three houses on one lot in a single family residency.
So look at the way we've drafted it on the upper left-hand side. One and only one accessory dwelling unit shall be allowed on any lot containing a single-family dwelling. So no matter how many single-family dwellings, there are only one accessory dwelling unit can be added to it.
Let me add a little bit to that. I don't think that the law contemplates that situation.
Well, I've got that situation.
And I think the way the city has dealt with that is reasonable.
To expand on this lady's question, my understanding is that it is precluding an ADU from separation of ownership or condominiumization. So if you're constructing an ADU within a condominium regime, doesn't that make the ADU a condominium?
No, you need to think about condominiumization of, or condo conveyance of the ADU as separate and distinct from that of the single family home. Now, you could say, well, it's no longer accessory, and that's probably true. But the law is at best ambiguous on this, and that underscores the importance of House Bill 265, which will go to the House for a vote on Thursday, tomorrow. And then I assume it'll be passed. It had a very strong committee vote. And that expressly prohibits condominium conveyance of accessory dwelling units unless the municipality wants to allow it. So it has to be, the municipality has to be proactive in allowing future condo conveyance of ADUs. Otherwise this bill, if adopted, would prevent future condominium conveyance.
Transitory nature of a community, and a condominium does the opposite, where it would stabilize it. So I'm just wondering what the thinking is behind eliminating condominiumization to begin with.
Well, I can't speak for legislators, but my take on this is that condominium conveyance was never intended by the drafters of the statute, me among them. The real important point here is to increase the rental stock of the state. And where you're allowing condominiumization of ADUs, that does not do anything to the rental stock. That is the greatest deficit we have in housing supply in New Hampshire is rental units.
My question is kind of future use. So if a ADU is created, whether an ADU or a garden cottage, and then at some point in the future, the property owner decides to sell the property, it's effectively a two-unit property, even though it's under the guidelines of the ADU. Is the new owner obligated to follow all the guidelines of ADU, you know, relative to, say, owner-occupied unit, or is it potentially a backdoor way for someone to create a two-unit property?
Right. Well, that's really why we had that last provision in there about requiring annual certification that you're meeting all of the requirements for an accessory dwelling unit, including owner occupancy. So if somebody comes in and wants to buy a property as an investment, they won't be able to use the second unit as an accessory dwelling unit anymore.
Is there a means to regulate that or police that?
Well, our zoning enforcement officer will, you know, we frequently find illegal apartments, and our zoning enforcement officer, when we find them, goes out and deals with them. So that would be the way to do it.
So I guess this final part of the question is, so if the property then is put up for sale, it doesn't need to be disclosed, I guess, that it has to follow ADU?
Yeah, and I think that, you know, we often find, again, in the same way, we find that properties are put up for sale as if they're three families, and we find out they're not legal three families, and we contact the realtor, and when we see the ad, and tell them he's got to change the ad, so we do that. And I should have mentioned earlier when I answered the question about who do I talk to about getting, because Vincent's right back here. Could you stand up, Vincent? This is the guy to talk to, and he's usually much better dressed than he is tonight. So.
Yeah.
my
one of your frequent questions up there is to do with institutional uses. So my question has to do, you have a single family home, but it's a group home, so it's institutionally owned by a nonprofit, and there are staff there 24/7. Is it owner-occupied?
Splitting hairs.
Good question. So this has come up in a number of different circumstances. So if a property, a single family home with an ADU is owned by an LLC, in fact, the chairman of my board has asked me that question. I don't have a good answer for him, and that puts me in an uncomfortable situation given that he's my chairman. Other sorts of, is it, if it's owned by a real estate trust, how can a trust as something other than a natural person occupy property? And at least with regard to trusts, I think you could look to the nature of the trust. If it is a revocable trust, it's essentially a transparent instrument, and who's controlling the trust is effectively the owner. And you could say that person would qualify as an owner for meeting owner occupancy standards. Whereas it's an LLC, it becomes a little more difficult. If it's a corporation, it's more difficult. If it is a nonprofit organization, it's the same. Well, nonprofit is probably a corporation, it's just a nonprofit corporation. I think the farther away you get from saying this person is the owner, the less likely you are to be able to say from the person who's controlling the property's perspective that I am the owner and I'm occupying it. So nonprofit, I'd say probably no.
Although I've quizzed four towns in the city house about this question, and different ones are interpreting it differently. So
I have no doubt.
Hampton is saying no, as that would be expected. And Esther is saying it's okay. It's kind of a gray area that the law doesn't come in.
That is true.
I just wanted to follow up on that. Since the requirement for owner occupancy is in our zoning ordinance, I think, and this is done by conditional use permit, I would think that we would be able to, at the planning board level, adopt the regulations for implementing the law, adopt rules of interpretation. And so we may just get down to that. And as it comes up, I'm sure there'll be many, many cases that we haven't thought of at this point, as there always are when we do zoning. And so we will be able to do some of these. Some of them may require amendments to the zoning ordinance. Others may be able to be dealt with through a regulation that interprets things.
Doug, we had some folks down front here who had questions. Vince?
Simple one. Does an ADU have to have a separate entrance? Or does that door between the units suffice?
They could have a common entrance and common space within from which you have two entrances to the individual dwelling units.
So you're saying that it does have to have at least one separate entrance?
I'm talking about exterior entrances on the exterior of the building. The answer is no. It does not have to have two exterior entrances. Obviously, you have to have different means of egress to meet life safety code, but no.
This is for Rick. In 2008, with the guidance of the inspection department, I put a small addition on for my mother, who is now 94 and still living in the addition. The only requirement was that I could not put a stove in. Am I going to have to go through the full permitting process again simply to put a stove in there now?
Yes, you will, because the reason you weren't allowed to put a stove in is because you weren't allowed to have a second dwelling unit.
Okay.
So this is actually, in order to create a second dwelling unit, you need to go through some type of, and I don't know your property, I don't know the details of it, but if it complies.
Vangelier, Kyle, we've talked before.
Yes, I know we have, but I don't know the details of your property, and so I can't tell you whether it's a conditional use permit for an accessory dwelling unit or whether your lot size and frontage would require you to go to the zoning board for a variance. Mm-hmm. But I don't know which it is, because I can't tell without looking at your property.
But I wouldn't have to go through all the inspection department and everything.
Well, yes,
it's existing.
Yes, you'd have to. The process we use in Portsmouth is that in order to start the process, you file a building permit application. So you file a building permit application with the inspections department. That gets sent over to the planning department, where we look at the land use issues and figure out what you have to do. Then you go through the boards, and then once you've gotten all your any and all land use approvals you need, then the inspections department issues your permit. And you would need to have, you know, either an electric permit or a plumbing permit or something like that.
I don't need a microphone. I just want to sit with Richard. I'd like to know when there comes information. Is it online already? And if the city, when this thing is going to be done with the information for sure?
Sorry, I didn't understand the question.
You might
know. Oh, yes, it's in our current zoning ordinance. So if you go to the planning department website, and it's actually in the full zoning ordinance by itself. I'm not sure it actually still exists as a separate ordinance as it went to the city council. It's in the zoning ordinance, yes.
Is it going to change for any reason? Was that the last? Is it done?
It's done.
Well, the zoning ordinance has been passed by the city council. It was passed by the city council on January 9th, so from that point of view, it's done. We may have to, in the future, make changes to it, and that if it were, it would go through the whole public hearing process. But as it is right now, it's there. People can start applying for this.
So also, it's on the homepage of our website, ps21.info, right at the top.
Another question down front here?
Yeah, is it conceivable or would it be allowed if someone created an ADU, but then it wasn't used as a dwelling, that they'd use it as an office?
Well, it would be a dwelling unit if you created it, because by creating it, you've got the bathroom and the stove and, you know, all the stuff that makes up a dwelling unit. You wouldn't have to use it as a dwelling unit, but you would be restricted by the other zoning requirements. The way we have it here, let's see if I can find it quickly. Look at the third one down. Neither the principal dwelling nor the accessory dwelling unit shall be used for any business, except that the property owner may have a home occupation use in the unit that he occupies as allowed or permitted elsewhere in the ordinance. So we do allow home occupations in our zoning ordinance, and they're kind of restricted. And so if you could convert, in essence, or not use the shower, you know, and use it as an office, provided that you went through the process, the separate process in the zoning ordinance to get that permitted. You see, you understand what I'm saying? So it's a possibility, but it's not automatic.
So my question is actually about this page. So if we own the property, we own both the garden cottage or the accessory dwelling unit and the house.
Yes.
Are we only allowed to rent one? So it says
you have to live in one of them.
What if we don't want to live there?
Then you can't do it.
We can't rent either.
You can't. It's not an accessory dwelling unit. If you don't live there, you have to take out the accessory dwelling unit.
We have to get rid of it.
Yeah. Yeah. Because it's not, the ordinance requires it to be owner occupied. We don't want this to be an investment property.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So Rick, looking at 10.3.14.33, neither the principal dwelling unit nor the accessory dwelling unit can be used for any business. Does a short-term rental qualify as any business? And would this be one way to address that issue which has been raised by the city?
I think that needs state legislation to do that, because right now a rental unit is a residential unit, it's not a business unit. Regardless, you know, there's nothing that says that a short-term rental, you know, somebody running for 30 days is anybody any different than somebody running for 25 days? You know, they're both residential uses. I think the state would have to define a short-term rental as a business use in order to make that distinction. If the state did that, then we'd be all set.
Okay, thanks.
So yep. Short-term rentals are totally okay as of right now.
Don't ask me that question, please.
I just didn't.
I'm not prepared to answer that. I mean, it's been an issue we've been discussing for a long time, and we don't have a resolution on it.
So legally, there's nothing.
Legally, It depends, it's really on a case-by-case basis whether it is, because we do allow permitting for bed and breakfasts. So if it is something like a bed and breakfast where you're doing a short-term rental and you know, it's within the parameters of the short of the bed and breakfast part of our ordinance, and you get the permit from the zoning board of adjustment, then you can do that, and then it's a short-term. A bed and breakfast is a type of short-term rental, I guess is what I'm trying to say. Where we have run into issues is whether something is an inn or something else, and we've had these issues, and it really is a policy issue that needs to be addressed.
And we've, could I add to that?
Yeah, sure.
Just note that the Department of Revenue Administration does seek to collect the meals and rooms tax on short-term rentals as they define it, which is a rental of, I believe, less than 185 days, which seems to me a long period, but that's in their administrative rules.
A couple more questions.
Right here.
After hearing a few of people's questions regarding having a dwelling unit and then eventually selling your property, if the intent was to provide more housing to supplement the demand, what's kind of the thought process behind having to have owner-occupied unit there and not being able to sell your property down the road to somebody that's investing? I feel like you're kind of putting it out there that you can have this, but down the road, you're limiting yourself, because if you have to remove an ADU, that's a huge cost and kind of defeats the purpose of putting it in the first place.
Well, it's not a huge cost, because all you have to do is take out the bathroom, and then you're done with it. It's a fairly small cost. I think that Portsmouth allows a ton of rental units, and we have a ton of rental units. We allow two families, four families, eight families, depending which zoning district you're in. So I think what we're seeing here is that, you know, this is a mandate. It's a statewide mandate that's been put on us, and we're responding to that mandate. I think what we wanted to do was to not make sure we were not changing the character of the neighborhood from a residential, you know, owner-occupied residential neighborhood to a transient neighborhood. And so the way we thought of doing that was to say that it's going to be, at least one of the units has to be owner-occupied in the long term. I think that once you get into a neighborhood that is primarily renter, not that renters are bad, I've been a renter, but I think it does change the character of the neighborhood, and that's what people in Portsmouth have always been afraid of when we've talked about turning single-family homes into two-family homes. And as I say, that, you know, that's really what this amounts to in our denser districts, is turning single families into the equivalent of duplexes, because the primary and the secondary unit will be the same size or similar sizes.
Yeah, let me add to that. Right? Yep. Yeah, there is in the legislative discussions on this, there's this attempt to balance the individual rights versus the interests of the community, and this is one of those points of compromise. So allowing municipalities to require owner occupancy it leans more in the direction of the interests of the community, because and I made this argument in legislative hearings, you know, who is the best enforcer of what goes on a property than the owner who is occupying that property? So we're, as Rick said, where you have exclusively rental situations, and recognize I work for an organization that is promoting rental housing, and this is a way of promoting some rental housing without giving up the whole boat.
Just a question for Rick. Is there a notice requirement in the application for the ADU for neighbors to be notified that there's an application?
Yeah, conditional use permit is a public hearing process. So you apply, the abutters are notified, it's published in the paper, and public, you know, it's published in town hall and the library. It's a regular public hearing, just like for any other zoning board or planning board public hearing.
Thank you. And the second question was, on the privacy concern, is there a difference, is there a similar or different standard for privacy if let's say a garage conversion or a carriage house is already built and then it's converted into an ADU? Because you mentioned privacy with regard to
the garden cottages.
Contiguous neighbors, right?
Yeah. What we were, the privacy issue is really, the reason we included that in there was because these are existing structures. They're existing structures, and they're closer to the lot line than would be allowed for a single-family home. So if you could build a single-family home, a 2.5-story single-family home 10 feet from the lot line, there's no logical reason why we should be more restrictive of the accessory dwelling unit. It's only when the existing unit is 5 feet from the lot line, and it's not much of a difference, but we want to make sure that as you get closer and closer to the backyard of the abutter, that we're more protective of them.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Other questions? Paul?
Yeah, Rick, I mean, concerning the garden colleges and detached ADUs in Portsmouth, mm-hmm. is the gross floor area the footprint of the building?
No.
Or the total living space?
The way we define gross floor area is the sum of the areas of all floors in the building measured from the exterior wall. So it's actually bigger than the total living space because you've got the walls, subtracting the walls.
So if a standard two-car garage is 30 by 25, you could not live above the two-car garage if you convert the first floor.
Exactly. Yep. But you could. And this is our first application is to keep the is to build the garage and build a second story on it that's a dwelling unit.
Okay. Yeah.
Other questions? Charlie.
I understood from Ben's presentation the state law takes effect June 1st, is that correct? So if the state law, which is the enabling legislation, doesn't take effect on June 1st, how can the city be open for business, so to speak, ahead of that time?
The state law is a mandate. The city has always been able to do this. There's never been any prohibition. The city communities have always been able to do accessory dwelling units under the zoning. So, you know, rather than we just got on a timeline and we got to the end of the timeline and we were done. It could have taken us another 4 months to do it, but we were able to get it done and get it passed in the city council in January. So it's not the state is not. This is not enabling legislation. This is mandatory legislation. So we have to do it by then, but we could do it earlier. And I will answer your other question. I'm sorry, I haven't gotten back to you yet. About a different topic.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Thank you very much for coming tonight. To keep up with our PS21, you can point your browser to ps21.info. Thank you very much.